So I'd like to begin by thanking the Parliament of Victoria for the honour of being asked to speak this evening to close the week-long exhibition commemorating the federal years in Melbourne. Can I also thank you for venturing out on what was forecast to be a soggy evening to listen to me. It doesn't seem to have eventuated. Speaking of weather, it was on a gleaming late autumn morning, and you can just imagine it, on the 9th of May 1927, that the new, albeit designated as only provisional Parliament House in Canberra, was officially opened by the Duke of York. The Commonwealth Parliament had adjourned for the final time in this building several weeks earlier, on the 24th of March 1927. According to a contemporary newspaper report of the last day's proceedings at Spring Street, as the Speaker vacated the chair, the assembled members, quote, unable to restrain their feelings, joined hands and sang Auld Lang Syne. Hansard reporters were beckoned to join them in the final verse. The national anthem was then sung, and joining in the reverie, an elderly man in the public gallery called out, goodbye and good luck to all of you. I was here at the first sitting and I am here at the last. His was quite a feat of endurance. Nearly 26 years had passed between the first and last sitting days of the Commonwealth Parliament at Spring Street. But how had it originally come to Melbourne in 1901? Like so many of the decisions involved in the making of the Commonwealth, it sprang out of a political compromise. The site of the capital in a federated Australia was far from a first issue or first order issue at the federal conventions of the 1890s. Those august gatherings were consumed by wrangling over such momentous constitutional design matters as the relationship between the respective powers of the House of Representatives and Senate and the appropriate distribution of revenue between the Commonwealth and the states. Nonetheless, the question of the location of the capital was sporadically debated during the decade. In New South Wales, there was a presumption that Sydney's status as the mother city meant that it had preeminent claim to be the seat of government in a federated Australia. Naturally, the other colonies, including Victoria, bridled at that sense of entitlement. At the third and final session of the 1897-98 Federal Convention, which was held in Melbourne in the Legislative Council Chamber in this building, the representatives of those colonies banded together to defeat a resolution that the capital be in New South Wales. The Victorian delegates were at pains to insist, however, that this was not because they coveted the capital for themselves. Indeed, according to an account of those proceedings, to prove their good faith in that matter, the Victorians moved that the seat of government should be in Victoria, only to then vote against it with the other colonies. Pretty perverse in some ways. Now, the draft constitution that emerged from the 1897-98 Federal Convention, which the public were asked to endorse at referendums held in June 1898, opted for discretion rather than valour on the subject. It postponed the decision of where to locate the national capital. The relevant provisions stated that, quote, that the seat of government of the Commonwealth would be determined by the Parliament, unquote. At the same time, inspired by the model of Washington DC in the United States, it went on to say that the seat of government would be situated within territory vested in the Commonwealth. This provision proved, however, to be one of the sticking points for the New South Wales public, who failed to give the draft constitution the required threshold of approval when they voted on it that June. In the aftermath of that setback for the Federation project, the colonial premiers, convening at the invitation of George Reid of New South Wales, agreed on a series of amendments to the draft constitution. The proceedings of that January 1899 Premier's Conference were secret, but a memorandum explaining the amendments said of the seat of government, quote, "In view of the strong expression of opinion in relation to this matter in New South Wales, the request of New South Wales that the capital be in that colony was granted, but with two conditions which Victoria insisted upon. One, that it should not be within 100 miles of Sydney, and two, that the Parliament should sit in Melbourne until it meet at the seat of government," unquote. Another slide. And that's the provision in the actual constitution on the seat of government, as it turned out, which reflects that, that memorandum, what it said there. Now, but the story does not quite end there, for there was still the question of where in Melbourne the Commonwealth Parliament would temporarily reside. Legislation passed by the Victorian Parliament in the latter months of 1900 dealing with the arrangements for the inauguration of the Commonwealth left open the answer. The Commonwealth could either occupy the Exhibition Building or Spring Street, or according to another unlikely suggestion, the Commonwealth and Victorian Parliaments could cohabit at Spring Street. Can you imagine that? The Premier, another slide. Now, the Premier of that time, Alexander Peacock, then wrote to the inaugural Prime Minister, Edmund Barton, in April 1901, magnanimously inviting the Commonwealth to nominate its choice of site, although signalling that Victoria's preference was that the Federal Parliament sit at the Exhibition Building. Following an inspection of both buildings, however, Barton replied that the Commonwealth had opted for Spring Street. Alfred Deakin, longtime member of the Victorian Legislature, the colony's preeminent federationist and now Attorney General in the Barton ministry, was reputedly instrumental in that decision. Apparently, the erudite Deakin could not bear the thought of being exiled from the parliamentary library at Spring Street. You'll be glad to hear that, Carolyn. There we are. We'll go forward. Now, in July 1901, Barton announced that he expected it would be necessary for the Commonwealth to borrow this building for 3 to 5 years. Yet an agreement signed between the Commonwealth and Victorian governments that December did not put any time frame on this loan, on the loan. In hindsight, it seems unlikely that George Reid, who had struck the deal of January 1899, and other New South Wales power brokers who had lobbied for the capital to be located in their colony, would have been quite so satisfied with their handiwork had they anticipated it resulting in Melbourne hosting the Federal Parliament for a quarter of a century. Equally, Victoria's parliamentarians would probably have been less accommodating of the Barton ministry wishes in 1901 had they appreciated that they were destined to be displaced to the Exhibition Building for such a lengthy period, an alternative home that many of them promptly began to grumble about. Now, when we think about it, even from our vantage point, a quarter of a century is a substantial portion of the life of our still relatively youthful Commonwealth. The 26 years that Melbourne was the seat of national government saw 8 different prime ministers and 18 separate ministries. Only three members survived the era. The indomitable William Morris Billy Hughes, who remarkably went on to serve for a further 25 years in the House of Representatives in Canberra and still comfortably holds the record for the longest federal parliamentary career. And then there was David Watkins and Senator George Pearce, just three of them. It was an era in which the foundational, institutional and nation-building legislation of the Commonwealth was enacted, including those enduring elements that were subsequently delineated as the Australian settlement. Among them, the White Australia policy, a centralised wage-fixing system and industry protection. It was an era in which the party system settled into a pattern to which it still fundamentally conforms, Labor versus non-Labor. It was an era in which Australia fought in the First World War and experienced what is conventionally regarded as its national coming of age, and an era in which the community was bitterly split on class and sectarian lines over the issue of conscription for overseas service in 1916-17. What I wish to speculate upon in the remainder of this evening's address is the impact that the Commonwealth Parliament sitting in Melbourne between 1901 and 1927 had on the life of the nation and this state in those years and beyond. We've grown accustomed, I think, to believing that the fact that Canberra is Australia's parliamentary and administrative capital does influence, even if in ways that are difficult to measure, the character of national politics and decision making. How often, for example, do we hear lamentations about the sterility and isolation of Canberra, about it being divorced from the lived experience of ordinary Australians? Commentators have argued that that disconnection contributes to the public's alienation with politics, while scholars have postulated that the workings of the Australian Federation have been influenced by its political headquarters being situated in Canberra. Perhaps surprisingly, however, precious little has been written about the effects of Melbourne being the seat of the federal government during the Commonwealth's formative decades. Moreover, the lone historical account that I'm aware of dismisses the idea that it had any significant implications for either the nation's or Victoria's political life. Tonight, I'll venture to disagree. It's a little known historical detail that in the Commonwealth's earliest days, when Parliament was in session at Spring Street, the nation's first Prime Minister, Edmund Barton, was accommodated in garret-style living quarters that had been improvised for him in an upper level of this building. John Brookle just took me on a tour before of it, where he believes Barton used to stay. There, later recollected one of his colleagues, Barton would, quote, sit up late with his particular friends in Cabinet, Deakin, Richard O'Connor and increasingly John Forrest. Their discussions often lasted until the early hours of the morning, and often before departing they cooked chops and made billy tea in the open fireplace in bush fashion, unquote. Delightfully evocative of the simplicity and intimacy of the infant Commonwealth, the New South Welshman Barton's living arrangements in Melbourne were also linked to the tyranny of distance that afflicted non-Victorian members. It was an era, of course, before aviation. This combined with the comparatively modest salaries of MPs and that there was no expenses entitlements meant that travel and accommodation caused significant practical and financial challenges for members. Some senators from outlying states coped by attending fewer than half the days on which Parliament sat. Some of the leading non-Victorian figures of the early Commonwealth Parliament found ways to manage. The former Premier and big man of West Australian politics, John Forrest, was sufficiently wealthy to hire a large suite of rooms in the Grand Hotel in Spencer Street for extended periods. Others shifted to Melbourne permanently, despite still representing electorates outside Victoria. Queenslander and future Labor Prime Minister Andrew Fisher was a case in point. He moved with his family to this city in 1906, and in 1912, during the midst of his second and major term in office, took up residence in the Oakley House mansion in East St Kilda to the sniggers of his Labor colleagues. But the Parliament's location in Melbourne conspired against other prominent non-Victorian figures. A notable example was George Reid, the former New South Wales Premier, arch-rival of Barton and Deakin, leader of the Free Trade Party, and opposition leader during much of the Commonwealth's first decade. Though briefly Prime Minister between August 1904 and July 1905, Reid's federal career never fulfilled its promise. His effectiveness as a parliamentarian and party leader was undermined by frequent absences from Melbourne while he remained in Sydney maintaining his legal practice there. Similarly, while Barton eventually found alternative accommodation in Melbourne, also at the Grand Hotel, prolonged separations from his wife and still relatively young family in Sydney, he could not afford to relocate them to Melbourne, weighed him down. It was a factor in his decision to relinquish the Prime Ministership after less than 3 years in September 1903. Whereas Barton and Reid suffered from the tyranny of distance, having the seat of government in Melbourne favoured another of the great Federationists, Alfred Deakin, who succeeded Barton as Prime Minister. In the study of the Prime Ministers of the first half of the 20th century that I've recently co-authored with Professors James Walter and Paul DeHart, we describe Deakin as the ringmaster of the early Commonwealth. Three times Prime Minister between 1903 and 1910, Deakin exercised the largest hand in crafting the institutions and policy regime laid down in that decade, thereby outfitting a nation that, as he had written in 1901, was beginning life as little more than a piece of political carpentry. His supremacy of that period is recognised by the use of the eponymous Deaconite settlement to describe the foundational legislation of the Australian Commonwealth. Deakin lived a very long stone throw from this building. The family home, Llanarth, was in Walsh Street, South Yarra. From there, Deakin walked, cycled or trammed to the Parliament and the nearby Commonwealth administrative offices. Not only was Deakin spared the challenge of travel and finding alternative accommodation, but his close physical proximity to Parliament was an important asset in the fluid environment of federal politics of those years. Let me explain. The party system was still in the process of settlement until 1909. Deakin's most productive ministry of 1905-08 was principally sustained by an alliance between the Liberal Protectionist grouping, which was dwindling in parliamentary strength, and the Labor Party. Getting legislation passed depended upon deft negotiation, tactical guile, and powers of persuasion. the cultivation of personal affiliations was critical. At this, Deacon was masterful, with perhaps his chief weapon, his beguiling effect as a conversationalist. There is ample evidence of this, but let me illustrate it with a reminiscence of Labor Senator George Pearce that also attests to the importance of place. Years later, Pearce recalled a chance encounter he had with Deacon one morning while the latter was strolling from his home to Parliament House. Quote, "We did not talk politics, but of literature. It opened up a new and more interesting world to my mind. After that morning, I used deliberately to waylay him in the park in order to obtain still further drafts of that fountain of knowledge," unquote. Pearce, in other words, was in Deacon's thrall. That Deacon became the dominant force of federal politics at that time was critical to the character of the nation-building edifice constructed in those formative Commonwealth years. As historian Stuart McIntyre writes, without Deacon's agency, it is likely that, quote, most of the legislation that formed the Australian settlement would not have been enacted, unquote. What is more, Deacon's ascendancy ensured that the Australian settlement had a distinctive Victorian inflection. Deacon was a descendant and torchbearer of the protectionist civilising variant of liberalism that emerged in Victoria in the colonial period. George Higginbotham had been one of his boyhood heroes. Studying law at the University of Melbourne, he came under the spell of Charles Pearson, and David Syme, who as proprietor of The Age, transformed it into a powerful mouthpiece for the Victorian liberal creed, was a friend and influential sponsor of his political career. Deacon was a prime mover of Victorian ministries in the 1880s that gave practical expression to this humane liberal philosophy through innovative measures, including factory legislation, wage boards, and welfare protection. Now, as Prime Minister, he was decisive in ensuring that version of liberalism was stamped onto the infant Commonwealth through such initiatives as the linking of industry protection to fair wages, supervised by the Conciliation and Arbitration Court, a system known as new protection, and old age and invalid pensions. The Australian settlement, or Deaconite settlement, could arguably also be called the Victorian settlement. Now, I want to turn to another Prime Minister and another episode. The Prime Minister of Labor's Billy Hughes, and the date is September 1916. Hughes had been elevated to the office the previous October following the resignation of Fisher, who was careworn by the pressures of governing during the war. Utterly persuaded of the righteousness of the British Empire's cause on the battlefields of Europe and convinced that Australia's post-war security depended upon her unsparing contribution to that cause, Hughes had returned to Australia in July 1916 from a barnstorming tour of the United Kingdom, set upon a course of introducing compulsory overseas military service. His dilemma, however, was that the Labor Party and the wider Labor movement was bitterly divided over that issue, but with the majority avowedly against conscription. Victory would also provide the means to neutralise those internal critics. Following a marathon meeting of the Labor caucus that narrowly ratified Hughes's plan, the Prime Minister announced his intention to the House of Representatives, sitting in Melbourne at the end of August. His next step was to try win over the state Labor branches. Now, the logic of geography ensured that his first destination was the Victorian Labor Executive, convened at Trades Hall in Carlton. His problem was the Victorian Labor was the most militantly anti-conscriptionist branch in Australia. Its radical temperament, the product of a complex configuration of local factors. Despite Hughes employing, quote, every one of his many oratorical, logical and political tricks, unquote, to persuade its members otherwise, the Victorian Executive unanimously repudiated his plea for support. Moreover, it promptly dispatched representatives to visit other state executives, including New South Wales, for the purpose of stiffening their anti-conscription resolve. The rest is history. Over the following 2 months, Labor fractured over the issue of conscription, or, in the colourful contemporary description of the Argus, it blew out its brains, a split that was crystallised when Hughes and his closest allies walked out of the federal caucus in November in the wake of the narrow defeat of the October referendum. The consequences of that breakup were profound. It destabilised the fledgling party system. It had a baleful legacy for Labor that languished in opposition for the following 13 years and did not enjoy another productive stint in office for twice as long, and it inflamed class and sectarian divisions that disfigured Australian society for decades to come. Now, we ought not to overstate the cause and effect here, but there are good grounds to suspect that the fact that Hughes was governing from Melbourne, the epicentre of the anti-conscription movement, exacerbated the explosiveness of politics at that critical juncture. Another implication of Melbourne hosting the federal parliament between 1901 and 1927, and this is pretty well incontrovertible, is that the early Commonwealth public service became predominantly a Victorian, or more accurately still, a Melbourne institution. At the time of Federation in 1901, there was a mere 1,400 Commonwealth public servants, most of whom were customs officers. By 1903, there were 7 departments: Attorney General's, Defence, External Affairs, Home Affairs, Postmaster General's, Trade and Customs, and Treasury, all of which were based in this city. Of course, not all the departmental officers came from Melbourne. For instance, Robert Garran, the inaugural secretary of the Attorney General's department and generally regarded as the greatest public servant of the first 3 decades of the Commonwealth, was from New South Wales, but he relocated to Melbourne. The bulk of officers did originate from this city. They worked in the CBD and from 1912-13 were accommodated in the purpose-built offices constructed at Treasury Place. By the time the transfer of the Commonwealth bureaucracy to Canberra was scheduled to begin in 1927, it comprised departments employing 37,300 officers, some 1,700 of which were on head office or central staffs. All of the latter were located in Melbourne, and many, it seems, were loath to shift. Melbourne-born Percy Dean, who had become Billy Hughes' private secretary in 1916 before being appointed secretary of the Prime Minister's department in 1921, epitomised the lack of enthusiasm for the new capital. "The best view of Melbourne," he archly quipped, "was from the back of a departing train." Despite the seat of Melbourne leaving Melbourne in 1927, it remained a very significant centre of Commonwealth administration for years to come. The transfer of public servants to Canberra was slow and painful, marred as it was by poor planning, inadequate accommodation, and quite possibly feet dragging by officials in Melbourne who shared Dean's low opinion of the so-called bush capital. By early 1929, less than one half of the service had relocated, and the onset of the Depression stalled further progress for several years. And while by the second half of the 1930s, all but two departments had been transferred, one of those left behind in Melbourne was Defence, with the result that the War Administration of 1939-45 was concentrated here. This is illustrated by the geographic distribution of meetings of the War Cabinet, the body tasked with detailed prosecution of the war, but whose activities spilled over into important fields of general policy. More than twice the number of meetings of the War Cabinet were conducted in Melbourne than were in Canberra. In fact, in the early 1950s, there were still more Commonwealth public servants in this city than in Canberra. The effect then that Melbourne became the administrative headquarters of the nation was long-lasting, that effect indeed. Now, as we end, near the end of this talk, I want to say a little about how the Victorian state political scene was impacted by the Commonwealth Parliament being in town. It's a less happy aspect of my story. Now, we left off with Victoria's politicians grumbling in 1901 about being exiled to what they deemed was the inferior accommodation offered by the exhibition building. The chambers were housed in the western annex of that building, which provided greater spaciousness than what they were accustomed to at Spring Street. On the downside, the substitute chambers lacked the ornate decorations that are such a feature of this place. Their acoustics were poor and the heating and cooling inadequate. Perhaps what most aggrieved members, though, and again you'll be pleased by this, Carolyn, was being deprived of access to the precious resource of the Spring Street Library. Nor did it help their process of adjustment that a number of experienced parliamentary officers had deserted them in favour of going to work for the Commonwealth. Victorian MPs displayed limited forbearance in the face of these irritations. The colourful Tommy Bent, soon to begin a five-year stint as Premier from 1904 to 1909, huffed that they were being treated like a little municipal council. Offended by the Barton Ministry's impertinence in choosing Spring Street, the crusty Conservative Sir Thomas McIntyre fumed that when a guest was invited into another's house, they were naturally, quote, offered the best chair, but usually refused to take it, unquote. The chorus of complaints won little sympathy from federal parliamentarians. A Queensland member of the House of Representatives provocatively inquired whether it would be possible for the Commonwealth to transfer to Sydney, where, quote, no doubt we will be received in a true federal spirit, unquote. With time, the complaints did abate as the Victorians became either reconciled or resigned to their exhibition building abode. Yet this was not before their collective pining for Spring Street prompted the State Parliament to briefly return there for 40 sitting days between December 1902 and April 1903. Now, beyond the inconveniences suffered by members, the Commonwealth Parliament's presence in Melbourne arguably had a more serious and parlous effect on the local state political scene. In the immediate aftermath of Federation, Victoria experienced the rise of a populist, anti-politics, anti-city movement originating in the Goulburn Valley town of Canberra. Known initially as the Canberra Movement, but morphing into the National Citizens Reform League by late 1902, it had over 200 branches across the state and some 15,000 members. By then it had thrown its political might behind the radical Tory Premier, William Hill Iceberg Irvine. A rallying cry of the League was that the transfer of legislative and administrative activities to the federal arena, a federal arena made especially material by its presence in Melbourne, demanded a proportionate reduction in the size and cost of state government. Irvine gave realisation to that manifesto in 1903 through a constitutional reform package that slashed the size of the parliament, cut the number of ministers and reduced their salaries, as well as attacking the political rights of public sector workers. While the National Citizens Reform League rapidly petered out, this sorry episode was a harbinger of a degrading of Victorian parliamentary politics. In the following decades, the hallmarks of the local political scene became chronic instability, marked by a high turnover of office. Minority government became the norm, with many ministries made and unmade on the floor of Parliament, and policy inertia. One of the root causes of this unhappy condition was the disorganisation of the party system that was linked to the arrested development of the local Labor Party and the disproportionately influential Country Party, both of which were connected to the gross rural bias in the electoral system. But the relevant point here is that with governments frequently transient and ineffective, and with parliamentary proceedings often being characterised by breathtakingly cynical deal-making between the parties, the reputation of and interest in Victorian politics declined. And this eclipse was exacerbated by the Victorian legislature sharing the city with its Commonwealth counterpart. The latter monopolised attention, which further encouraged apathy towards the local political scene. In turn, the combination of the seat of government being in Melbourne and the abject condition of state politics encouraged talented aspiring politicians to focus their ambition on the federal rather than the state sphere. A flight of talented state MPs to the Commonwealth was certainly apparent. This exodus began in 1901, and while a phenomenon not unique to this state, it was very costly to the quality of the Victorian Parliament. Among those who made the transition at the inaugural federal election were the immediate past premiers George Turner and Alan McLean, Alfred Deakin, the future High Court Judge and Governor General Isaac Isaacs, and H.B. Higgins, another future High Court Judge and President of the Court of Conciliation and Arbitration. Moreover, the loss of some of the best and brightest of Victorian politics to the greener pastures of the Commonwealth Parliament continued. For instance, the aforementioned William Hill Irvine Premier from 1902 to 1904, entered the House of Representatives at the 1906 election, and went on to be Attorney General in the Federal Ministry of Joseph Cook. Another example was William Watt, Premier from 1912 to 14, and often touted as the rightful political heir to Alfred Deakin, who resigned to stand for the Commonwealth Parliament in 1914 and proceeded to be Treasurer under Billy Hughes and Acting Prime Minister for 16 months during 1918-19. A phenomenon most evident on, though not exclusive to, the non-Labor side of politics, it persisted even after the seat of government moved to Canberra. Perhaps the biggest fish of them all to make the jump was Robert Menzies, who transferred from the state to federal parliament in 1934. The departed left behind an ossifying state parliamentary personnel. One small measure of this is that 10 members of the legislature, 8 from the Assembly and 2 from the Council, survived the 26 years of exile at the Exhibition Building. Remember, earlier on I said only 3 Commonwealth parliamentarians did. 10 did in the state legislature. And by the time of the return to Spring Street, the average age of those veterans was approaching 70. Shortly after the Commonwealth Parliament had relocated to Canberra in May 1927, the official organ of the Victorian ALP Labor Call remarked, quote, "Victoria's concern with state politics has been overshadowed by its concern with federal politics. The federal fray is now certain to lose its mastery. It will be more really national in a diffused spirit and scope. The point is that there will be an increase and acceleration of attention in state politics. It will be to Victoria's advantage and, we believe, shift the stagnation of years," unquote. Implicit here is the question of whether, on balance, it had worked in Victoria's favour to host the federal parliament for the first quarter of a century of the Commonwealth. I have gestured tonight to some of the benefits, yet neither was it without its costs. I'll conclude with another thought piqued by the Labor Call's 1927 commentary. That is its prediction that with the move to Canberra, the federal fray, as it put it, would become more really national. This was the hope of Stanley Melbourne Bruce, the incumbent Prime Minister in 1927, who, fittingly enough, was also the first holder of that office not to have sat in one of the colonial legislatures. Speaking at the opening of Parliament House on that gleaming Canberra autumn morning, he had implored his fellow legislators to think and act nationally. It was an appeal that seemed more than a little incongruous in that setting, with Bruce speaking from the steps of a building looking out upon a thinly scattered settlement of an isolated small town. And yet, the shift from Melbourne to Canberra did represent something of a symbolic watershed in leaving behind the colonial era. So long as the federal parliament remained in this city, or if it had been in Sydney for that matter, there was a sense of it being yoked to the past. Bruce and his fellow prime ministers of the early Commonwealth had regularly felt frustrated and powerless in pursuing national objectives in the face of the parochialism of the colonies turned states. The move to Canberra did not, of course, in itself resolve this dilemma, but it was nonetheless another step on the journey to national self-realisation. And it would be in Canberra, that most unlikely of capitals, that in the decades to follow, the Commonwealth's authority truly began to flourish. Thank you.